Welcome. Hi, we are live at the Hop. Woo-hoo. So excited to have you guys with us morning, right?
Yes.
The church doors may be closed, but God's church is always open.
Yes.
So we're just so glad to have you here with us today, and we're glad to be with you today.
Mm-hmm.
So grab your coffee. Get your family, gather around your device.
Yes.
Because we're going to have church this morning, right? We're gonna fellowship. We're gonna worship together. Yes. We're gonna pray together, and we're gonna talk about God's word.
Amen.
So we're gonna have church together this morning. And for those of you that are joining us and you don't know who we are, I'm Pastor Jesse. This is Natasha and
Hello.
Jason,
Hi.
A couple worship leaders here at the Plattsburgh House of Prayer. So I'm so blessed to have you guys here
this
morning
so
with me.
Yes.
It's a beautiful day.
Such a good day.
Yes.
Such a good
and day. I'm so glad to have Merritt with us this morning.
Oh my God.
John
Hi.
Curtis is
Tanya's
with us.
In the house.
All right. Judy. Hello, Judy.
Molly.
How you doing?
Hi, Judy.
I'm surprised
have you guys
Molly's
seen
not.
Judy's yard?
No.
Judy has an amazing pond.
Oh,
and,
I need
like,
to go. Where does she
awesome
live?
Yard.
I need some ideas, Judy.
She's been working for weeks.
Hit me up,
on
Judy.
Her yard.
I need
it's
those.
Amazing.
Send some pics.
Send some pics. I need some.
There's Cassandra. Hi, Cassandra. Are you
hey,
back
Cassandra.
From
what's going on?
How was the warm weather?
Yeah. How was Alabama? Hopefully, you're back home.
Wow.
Yep, we got Molly with us.
RJ, Nancy.
Hey.
Gail is there.
Gail,
we have Monica.
Tanea. How you doing, Tanea?
Water balloon. My kids, when you say the same word at the same time, they say water balloon.
Oh, really?
We said
oh,
at the same
okay.
Time, so.
I,
water balloon.
We used to say, Jinx, you owe me a Coke.
See, no, we don't want to have to
yeah,
give
no,
out Coke.
No Diet Coke for me.
Awesome.
Tanea is
yes,
here.
Yes, Tanea's with us. All right, look at that.
Here's Connie. I'm not
Tanya.
Sure. Hello, Connie.
Hello,
Connie.
Tanya.
Hi, Connie.
Michelle.
Holly.
Michelle. Nancy's with us
Christina's
this morning. So glad
here.
You're with us.
So fun.
Alberta. Jared Hogel.
Hey, the Hogels. How you guys doing?
Valerie Smith.
I know. I'm
good
surprised
morning.
They're not hiking today. Those nice. Hogels,
they probably
completed
will.
Completed the Lake Placid Niner, maybe?
They
have
really?
You completed it? I don't
yeah.
know.
Yeah, we got some that's hikers. Been... We have a lot of hikers in our church, actually.
You guys
do,
are
yeah.
amazing.
Hey, who's
yeah.
a hiker out there?
Yeah,
yes.
So you're a hiker.
Throw up a heart.
A heart. Yes.
If you guys are hikers out there,
Shed
I would be like hearting it like 10 times
some
in
love.
A row. I'd be like, me.
Yeah.
Jonathan,
Gomez,
the Gomez family is here.
Oh, the Gomez's. How you guys doing?
I saw Jason and Christina on a little walk yesterday.
Yeah.
Which is nice, yeah.
Yes. The Persons are here with us.
Persons, Jared, Caitlin, how you doing, kids? So glad you're with us.
I just saw some angry faces. I think those guys don't like hiking. No. Are you guys
yeah. anti-
oh anti-hikers.
Thinking exercise. Thinking exercise.
No. They don't go up. They go, down the valleys.
They're
negative hikers.
Yeah, right.
Maybe that, is that skiers? They go down?
Yeah, they yeah, skiers.
There we go.
There you go.
All right. We're so glad to have you guys with us this
yes,
morning. Man, I had a point in this week where just the presence of God washed over me, just for a moment. Have you ever had that?
Yeah.
Where you're either, I was actually putting screws into a deck, and all of a sudden,
yay.
This presence washes over me, and I don't know how to describe it, but I just felt the closeness of God and God's love for humanity.
So good.
And it just made me realize this is why we do what we do. This is why we gather on Sundays. This is why, you know, we sit in the seat and we talk with you guys and we talk about Jesus. And because there's something so much bigger than each one of us. And I think we all realize that, that man, I've encountered God, and there's just so much more out there than myself.
Amen.
And we come to gather to encourage one another and to talk about God. I just love this, and I just thank you guys for tuning in, and hopefully you're encouraged this morning.
Yes.
With our fellowship, with prayer, with worship,
yes.
And with the Word of God that we're going to talk about later on. So,
yeah.
So
crazy,
Jesus.
Absolutely. We want to make sure this morning to give a shout out to all our graduates.
Yes.
Graduated this weekend.
Yes, for this is
good
a
job.
Basic shirt for those of you who don't know.
Yes.
Representing Basic and our graduates.
Basic.
Graduating out of Basic.
Love, Basic.
Love you guys.
Yep.
Our church would not be the same without our college students.
No.
That is right. And we miss you so much, but we're so proud of you. Oh my gosh.
Wow.
What an amazing
that
accomplishment.
Is so crazy.
Yep. Not only just graduating, you know, school is hard as it is, but you got through COVID-19 and graduated.
What?
Yes. So
totally
we're so
new.
Proud of you.
No one will ever forget the year you graduated.
That's
yeah,
right.
Think
no,
about that.
Yeah.
Think about that.
So awesome.
Yeah, you're like in the books.
Yeah, so I just want to go through the names, and some of your names, guys, I might say wrong, so I'm so sorry. Nicholas, Kenneth graduated, Elizabeth Barker graduated, Tony graduated. Woo, Tony!
Yay.
Ben, is it Chacha? How do we say his last name?
I don't know how to say his last name. I always say Ben.
We just say
Ben. Ben. Jared Silverman graduated. Taryn Gold
all right.
graduated.
Congratulations,
wow.
guys.
Laura Kenyon graduated. Brooke Lauren graduated.
Yes.
Madeline graduated.
We're not
and
Madeline.
Graduated.
Woo. We're not going to have any college
Woo.
Students left
I know,
there.
I know. Right. I know. It
sad,
makes
but that's
me
yes.
so
sad. The sad part, we do. We graduate students, and sometimes we lose them.
I know.
To obviously the career that they have. But the good thing about students is we always get new faces.
Exactly. I know.
And we get to meet some great new students and great people. So.
And they're always keeping in touch with us, the ones that move away.
Yes.
And
yes. I guess there's
always...
two more that are are transferring.
Oh, okay.
Also. So, yeah.
Okay.
It's a huge,
yeah.
huge transition. So
well,
we're
going
to miss
you
guys. You. We'll be praying for you, definitely.
For sure.
And
definitely.
Yes.
God has great things for you.
Amen.
Yes, he does.
Man, believe
so
that. No matter what
he
happens,
yeah.
no matter what circumstances you find yourself in, believe that the purpose of God for you is higher than your circumstances.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Amen.
That's a word to take to the bank.
Amen.
All right. Praise the Lord. So, yes, congratulations
so
to all
Congrats.
Our graduates. Something I wanted to talk about before we get into some worship in a little bit is a piece of scripture from Ephesians 6, and it's a famous piece of scripture, and so many of us know it, and if you don't know it, go find it. It's in Ephesians 6, verse 11, and he says in this scripture, he says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, right?
Yeah.
We wrestle against powers and influences and principalities. And what he's saying through this scripture is a lot of our issues and our problems that we're dealing with aren't the people around us. They're the influences that we're feeling. Right?
I know. Are you sure?
Because
like, so many people.
Because this week, and probably a lot of you like there, and there's some weeks that I find myself, or a day that I find myself like this, where I just feel like crawling in a hole and staying there. Have you ever been there?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like every morning for about 2 hours, and I'm like, okay.
And I want to let you guys know that you're not alone in this. I believe everyone feels this.
Yeah.
You know, some people, man, why do I feel this way? I think everyone actually feels that at some point, at some time, mm-hmm. and probably quite often.
Yeah.
A lot of it is what we do with it.
Okay.
Do you know what
okay.
I mean? It's what we do with that feeling. And I was reminded as that kind of feeling came on me, like, man, I just want to crawl in a hole and just wait for things to blow over.
Yeah, right?
Like, or maybe the world will forget about me.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Easier.
But God brought this scripture to my mind, and it reminded me that it's not about the people around me. It's not about my workplace, my family, my neighbor, whatever it might be, because we so quickly get like to point the finger, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
At what is the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know?
Yeah.
We like to point the finger.
Yeah.
What God is saying is, listen, you're not fighting against flesh and blood. It's not the person next to you. It's not your neighbor. It's not your family. There's influences and spiritual pressures, dark spiritual
yes.
pressures
wow.
that are pressing in on us.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to recognize that and begin to fight it the
right
way, right?
That's right.
Wow.
And
yes.
as I began to kind of feel that, I just wanted to being a whole, right? Yeah. I just began to declare the wonderful works of God and the anointing of Jesus Christ in my life. So that the devil, the enemy, those spiritual pressures had no right in me. And you just begin to declare the truth of God about our lives.
Yeah.
And that's how we begin to do like this warfare, this battle against not flesh and blood, but the real things that are bothering us.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, the enemy wants us in so much chaos. And the things that really matter when we stand before the Lord, you know, what did we do with love? Who did we love? What are the relationships that we developed here on this earth? And it has nothing to do with stuff or so-called ministries, or it's all about who did you love and how well did you love. And I think the enemy wants to destroy love and the ability to have relationships. I mean, I see it all the time, like struggling to maintain friendships, and nothing ever goes it's always surface relationships. They never go deep. And just that reality that with God, we have the ability to love and to love deeply.
Yeah.
And the enemy wants to destroy that. So recognizing when you're in the middle of one of those kind of battles that, oh my gosh, it's not this friend, or it's not this person, or it's not my spouse.
No.
It's the enemy. And he wants to destroy the one thing that I can present before the Lord and say, I loved with your love. I loved well. And
that's so good.
So we just wanted to encourage you this morning, if you're struggling with this, which I think we all are.
I have suffered that. I mean, when somebody would, like, people that I would look up to, even mentors or my my supervisors, they'd give me some kind of positive, you know, criticism or something that would help me in my work in the future, I would take it as an offense. Like, they're just trying to correct me, I do everything wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, like, the enemy would want me to think that,
right.
You know, but...
Right.
You know, my supervisors are just trying to invest into me so it's for a better future, you know?
Right.
And I'd get, you know, the spirit of offense. It's like, no.
Yeah.
I need to, you gotta keep it in check for sure.
It's so hard, but because inside we are insecure, like I'm insecure.
Oh,
whoops.
Ooh, I just spilt that all over.
you can't feel it right
I know. I like a lot of coffee.
There'll be more coffee after.
No. I'm like hoarding the toilet paper, hoarding the coffee.
It's all good. How are you guys? You guys got your coffee?
Mm-hmm.
We want to see your
pictures. I got it all over me.
We want to see your pictures today of what church at home looks like for you.
Yes, that'd be great.
Today, and we just want to keep you encouraged.
Yes.
I think being like almost 8 weeks into this, there is just that tendency. We're just kind of sick of it. And we just want to glorify God through it and keep him as the focus. So this morning, we would love to see how you are, you know, putting Jesus first in your lives and opening up your home for community right now as we all gather together. We're taking that time to have community and have fellowship with each other. Look at Merritt's got his coffee.
Yay.
There we go. Nice.
I'm going to wring out my pants later. I'm not going to waste
this. Jesse usually always does that.
Like spill it all over.
Connie writes the gospel of peace.
Yes.
Shield of faith. Amen. Put it on.
Oh, she's got
that. Put on the armor of God.
Yes, Ephesians 6, the armor of God. So good.
All right.
Yes, so good.
Love that. Yeah, and that will save a lot of marriages, relationships.
Yeah.
Yes.
All those things is realizing that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood.
It's so true.
I know it saved our marriage. I'm sure it'll save a lot of others, that revelation. So.
It has saved us, guys.
That's so good. Yeah, I was listening to a message this week that said we're so quick to receive from the devil.
Yes.
Like those feelings of being, I was like, whoa, that's intense. Like, that's a bold statement, but it's so true. Like, how quick are we to, you know,
just
fall into anxiety? Or, or, you know, just confusion or anything. And God is just like, I'm the God of provision. I am the God of, you know, I protect you.
So. And he's been so faithful to us.
I know.
You'd think that we would start to, align our lives more with him than with the enemy's message. But,
He never gives up. He loves us so much. Yes. And we just repent. We ask for forgiveness. And we accept his love again.
Amen.
We receive his love.
Awesome.
Amen.
Yes.
Cassandra says, don't cry over spilled coffee.
my mic away.
But she ends with keep the faith, brother.
Keep the faith. There's more coffee. It's like thanks, all over. It's all good. Thank you for that encouraging message. All
right.
Michaela!
Is she on there?
Yes.
Hey, hi, Michaela.
Hey, Ashley. How you doing?
Tanya. So
glad to have you with us today.
Yes. Who else did I just see join?
All right.
It's this is Sally fun. Hughes.
I like this.
Yeah, Sally's with us today.
Sally Hughes got a gift card last week.
Good morning. Yes. Oh my gosh.
Oh yeah.
That was so awesome.
Yeah.
And we were able to give out even two more. We added two more to the list.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
So we sent out, what would that have been, 12?
11.
11 gift cards.
Right?
Well, no, 11, we 12, picked 11, 13. We did 13 in all.
Oh, that's right,
we picked 11 names, yeah.
Yeah. Oh,
wow.
My gosh. So,
that's so cool.
So fun. Moms, you are amazing.
So hopefully you guys got those. We're so glad that we were able to give you a gift for being awesome moms. So,
so good.
Praise God. Mm. All right. So we're going to get into worship here.
Ready?
I'm ready. I've got a good one today.
Yes. So I love what you said, Jason. You guys can get going. You can get all set. How quick we are to believe the lies of the enemy, whether, you know, it's that feeling of something speaking to you that you're worthless. And we jump on that hook, line, and sinker. But yet when God kind of talks to us about our worth, sometimes we're so hesitant to believe it, right? And I want to just encourage you, the presence of God would never call you worthless, because God doesn't create worthless things. Amen. God creates the best. And God created you. He created you for a purpose. And God created you to shine in the glory of God. Amen. So as we just turn to worship this morning, shut the lies of the world and the lies of the enemy out, and just open your heart to receive what God has for you today. As the music begins to play and we just set our hearts on Jesus Christ, let God speak to you this morning. Let Him encourage you. Let Him fill you with hope. Let Him, you know, breathe upon the fire that He's put within you this morning. Amen. So, Father God, as we just enter into praise and worship, God, I pray that we would allow Your voice to be louder than all the others. God, that we would allow You to speak into our lives, God. Father, and move within us, Father. Give us those moments, maybe even today, give us that moment where Your presence washes over us, God, and we begin to see from Your eyes and Your perspective, God. So come, Holy Spirit, in power, in might, and in Your presence this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.
For You have never failed me yet. still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
This is
built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Yes, Jesus. Jesus is our cornerstone. Jesus is our salvation. Jesus is our righteousness. Jesus is our victory. For those of you out there that might be struggling, that might be going through something that you think maybe no one else understands, believe me, Jesus does. And Jesus paid the price for you to be victorious. Maybe not in the world's eyes of what victorious is, but Jesus has paid the price for you to be victorious in your soul and in your spirit, for you to come out of whatever is afflicting you, revealing the glory of Jesus Christ in living out the purposes that God created for you. So Father, we just thank you that our anchor, that our foundation is not in our own works or anything that we can build on our own. Oh, surely those would fall quickly, right? But it's in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And if you haven't turned to Him yet, please do. Do it now, don't wait. The Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart. He's moving on the inside of you, drawing you into the place of inviting God into your life and for you to walk out the destiny and the purpose that God created for you. And that's to be in relationship with a real and living God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I love His word. All those who call out upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. That was a wonderful time of worship. Thank you, guys. Really moved. I don't know if you heard me shouting in the background, but I loved it. Praise you, Jesus. It just reminded me of all that we have in Jesus Christ. Stop looking out at what I think I have, but begin to look at the blessings and the gifts that Jesus Christ has given me. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, so we're going to be getting into the Word of God here. Right?
Here we come. Coming in hot.
I got my Bible under here, so if you don't have your Bible, go grab it. If you
have
it on your phones, yep. Open up your Bible app and tap to Luke. Actually, is where we're going to start. Luke. And actually, what I'm going to share with you today was simply a conversation that I had on the porch.
We had a lot of conversations on the porch
with my mother, actually. But we were just talking about the Word of God together, and she was sharing something that she heard, and it really just sparked something in my heart. And I was like, man, I just really want to share that, because I really think it's a timely word for all of us here in this place. Because I knew it was a timely word for me, so I'm assuming it's a timely word.
If anybody knows timely words, it's Mama Janice. That's for sure.
That's right.
So, which actually goes to it points to the fact that we can grow and learn so much when we just sit around and talk about Jesus Christ and His word. Amen.
Two or three are gathered.
I've gone and I've heard some awesome preachers, and I've gotten a lot from, you know, awesome preaching and someone preaching the word, and that's a good source of feeding your spirit. But man, there's also a good source, and that's just hanging out with other believers. Talking about Jesus.
It's some of the most extravagant moments.
And that's why we say, you know, one of our values and vision that we have is we find freedom through small groups, and it's really just those conversations and encouraging one another in the Word of God that really opens up doors, illuminates our mind and heart to who God is, and we find freedom in those places. So I encourage you to have more God-centered conversations with friends. Amen.
Around the campfires.
I had someone reach out and said, hey man, I really feel God is calling me back into relationship with Him.
Wow.
You know, and they asked for my help, and I said, I would love to help you. And I encouraged them, one of the things that you need to do is just get around other believers and just start talking about God. And because other believers are going to encourage you in who you are in Christ, but they're also going to talk about the Word of God and how it impacts us.
I know. I love when they say that in the Song of Solomon's. It's like all the daughters are, they're talking about, you know, where, and the Shulamite, she's, where can I find my prince? And the friends say, just follow the crowd, just follow the believers.
Get in with them
and you'll find them there.
That's right.
I love that.
Awesome.
So good.
Yes, good stuff. So turn to Luke 8. I have it marked here with my little marker in the Bible. And I'm going to read a chunk of scripture, so bear with me. And I'm going to pull a thought out of this chunk of scripture, and that's kind of what I want to talk about today. So put your thinking bootstraps on as we read through this.
I'm ready.
And hopefully you're able to follow me through the word here. So it's Luke 8, and we're going to be starting in verse 26. All right. And it says, they sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but he had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had commanded the evil spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus,
bad day.
Yeah. Isolation.
And that's what we do, right? Yeah, that's what I was talking about. Those demonic influences. It drives us to what? Crawl in a pit.
Hide. Yeah. Yeah.
To those places of isolation. Yeah. Solid, you know, the solitary places.
Shame.
Anyways, let's continue on. Yeah, Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "Legion," he replied, because many demons had gotten into him, and they begged him repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into them, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. So all these pigs, these were actually the, they were pig farmers over there, and this is part okay. of their sustenance, right? Okay. So all these pigs, they ran and jumped into the lake, down the bank, and was drowned. And when those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. And when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Mm. Those who had seen it told the people of how the demon-possessed man had been cured, healed. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. Now that's a mouthful of scripture.
Yeah. That's a lot.
And there is a lot of awesome principles and things that we could talk about that apply to our lives and apply to our lives even now. But there's one thing that I really want to hone in on today. One point that I want to bring out and for us to kind of really think about and apply to our lives. And is this, what Jesus uses to bring freedom to people will disrupt worldly comfort.
What?
Let me repeat that because this is the main point. What Jesus uses so to bring freedom to people will disrupt worldly comfort.
That's right. Oh.
Jesus brought freedom to this demon-possessed man. Jesus came in this boat and he comes out on the shore of the lake and he's walking in and this demon-possessed man comes because at the presence of Jesus, demonic things are like stirred are stirred and they go crazy. Anyways, so this demon-possessed man comes and runs and falls at the feet of Jesus and Jesus brings freedom to this demon-possessed man. But it affected the livelihood of others.
The whole right. country, yeah.
It affected the livelihood of others, affecting the comfort that they got from this world.
Wow.
And they disliked it so much, it angered them. It says it angered them. And they wanted nothing to do with Jesus and told him to have to leave because it had affected their worldly comfort. Right?
Right.
Like, and, we don't need you right now. So, like, we're fine.
And we were having
Leave
this conversation
alone.
On
yeah.
this porch,
like, who are you?
And it really hit me because let me tell you a story, and Natasha can verify
Uh-oh.
That I was kind of walking around my house, very agitated and frustrated, because.
When was this?
It's a daily occurrence. So I was frustrated. And I was talking about how, because I raise beef cattle. I have some beef cows and I sell them for money.
You might not want to say that with this meat shortage.
Yes. I'm just kidding. Well, that's the point. Okay. So I have these beef cattle and I cannot sell them for the money that I would normally get.
Yep.
And I'm frustrated right now because the beef prices have bottomed out.
Which is crazy.
Which yeah. is crazy. So I'm sure. They're giving me pennies for the beef that I would sell.
Yeah.
And part of it is because they can't open up the slaughterhouses, they can't get the people there, and then you have to register your animal, and there's so many people trying to register that they're just giving you pennies for it because there'll be another guy right behind you. That, anyways, this supply and demand is microeconomics for those of you out there. But the reality is I was kind of walking around my table, and I was frustrated, and I actually expressed it to her, like, man, I got these beef cows that I want to sell. I would love the money for, because I could put it to this, and I could put it to that, and I could get this from it, and all these things. And I'm angry that we're in this COVID-19 thing. Why won't it just end? And why can't I get my beef cattle, right? Sold and get my money. So I can revel in the worldly comfort that I can get from those things. And as we were sitting and having this conversation about Luke 8, it kind of hit me of how God is using COVID-19 to reach a lot of people.
He is.
To set them free and to bring them into the family of God.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right?
That's so good.
And when we kind of talked about this, it really hit my heart squarely.
Yeah.
This idea that here I am, I'm angry at God because it's affecting my worldly comfort.
Yeah.
But yet God is using it to bring freedom to others.
Yes.
Wow. Right?
Oh, God.
The Apostle John says it this way. I have a scripture here in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. And it reads this: "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, the pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, for whoever does the will of God abides forever." And what I began to realize as we kind of talked about all this stuff, and even through what John says, is I need to begin to find joy in the movement of God and not in my worldly comforts.
Whoa.
Yes.
Right?
So good.
We need to begin to find joy in the moving of God, in the movements of God, whether in our life and those around us, maybe our nation or maybe the world, whatever it might be. We need to find our joy in the movement of God and not our worldly comfort.
Whoa.
Because I really believe we've come to a place in Christian society or Christian culture that we view worldly possessions as godly blessings.
Yes, we do. I'm there.
Right?
Just got a new car.
So we're starting to tie worldly blessings to godly, to God's blessings. Like if I have enough, if I've got this, if I've got that, then God loves me and He's blessing me.
Yeah.
Right.
And for that mentality, it doesn't work for most of the world, actually.
Yeah.
Because what about the poor guy that loves Jesus to death?
Yeah.
That doesn't have hardly anything.
Right.
Does God not bless him?
Yeah, right.
Does God not love him?
Right.
You see, we're coming to a place in church culture, Christian cultures, where we're tying the plenty or worldly comfort to God's blessings. Mm. And I think God wants to dismantle that reality, that we are blessed and we are victorious in God, and we have joy in God, and we can have it outside of worldly comfort.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right?
It's like Paul when he was content in all situations, in jail, in the outskirts. It's like he was content in every situation. I'm like, make me more like him.
I think the only way he got there, though, was
I know, and we're getting through it.
Here we go.
Let me
here
just
we
take
go.
Some worldly possessions on my way. A little bit more comfort.
One thing at a time.
So there's three things that we must realize. I'm going to hit these three real quick. Three things that we must realize, and one is as the return of Jesus draws closer, demonic activity will increase.
Okay.
Now, we also have to really begin to realize that there is a devil. If there's a God, then there's a devil, right?
Yeah.
The scriptures are pretty clear on that. So, with the devil comes demonic influences, and that's what we talked about earlier, those principalities and powers and influences. So as the return of Jesus Christ draws closer, demonic activity will increase. Mm-hmm. Ephesians 6:11, let me read it actually from the very beginning. It says, "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil."
Mm.
See, the enemy is scheming against you right now.
Yep.
The enemy, the devil, is scheming against us right now.
Yes.
That we would not glorify Jesus Christ through our lives. So the enemy is scheming against us. But he goes on to say, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Mm. And the truth is, and the devil knows it, and all his underlings know it, when Jesus returns, right, he's going to subdue.
They're in trouble.
Subdue the world, right? So, and he casts all those into the abyss, but we're not there yet.
Right.
There is a time. There is a return. There is a time when Jesus Christ is coming. And the closer we get to that time, the closer we get to the coming of Jesus Christ, demonic activity is going to increase.
Because they're in panic.
Yeah. Yes.
It's like, what?
So as the return of Jesus draws closer, the activity of these influences will increase. And it's going to be in nations, it's going to be in governments, it's going to be in society, and it's going to be within people, right? But the one thing I want us to understand is that we don't have to fear.
No.
This idea, I hate when people bring up, you know, the devil and all these demonic influences, and all of a sudden we begin to panic and get afraid, and we don't have to.
No.
Because what we have, the power of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came at his first coming to subdue the power of the enemy. So Christ is above them in power. So we don't have to fear. John 16, verse 13, I believe, it says, in the world you will have tribulation. How many realize that? We're in tribulation. But take heart, he says. But take heart. In other words, don't be afraid.
Right.
Don't get all filled with anxiety. Don't panic, but take heart. I have overcome the world.
Yeah.
You see, in me there is victory.
Yeah.
No matter what it looks like around you or what's going on around you, you are victorious in me if we will cling to that reality, right?
Yes.
So we don't need to be afraid, but one thing we do have to realize is as the day gets closer, demonic activity is going to increase. Mm-hmm. The second thing is what God uses to bring freedom to people bound by these influences will disrupt worldly comfort.
So good.
Will disrupt worldly comfort.
I haven't said amen yet.
Come on, give me an amen. Somebody give me an amen.
That's so crazy. So I know.
It does. It hits like, home. Oh. It hits home, right? We have to really understand that victory does not equal worldly comfort.
Yeah. That's right.
And I think we've come to that place in church culture where we think victory equals worldly comfort. And that's not it at all.
No.
Yep. And in fact, as Jesus comes to bring freedom to more and more people, it's going to cause worldly discomfort.
Mm.
And we have to begin to understand that and rewire how we think into finding joy in the movement of God, finding success and fulfillment in the movement of God through our lives as we see his kingdom grow and not in worldly comfort.
Right.
Yeah.
Well. Right. And if you think about it, when it comes to this whole COVID-19 thing, it changes everything, doesn't it?
Yes.
When we begin to realize the worldly comfort that we might be feeling is actually a good thing because God is saving souls and lives and setting people free in the midst of this.
Yes, not just about us.
Yes.
Yeah.
So instead of me crawling into a hole and waiting for this to blow over, I become a part of the movement of God to see his kingdom expanded.
Yes, we're partakers in the gospel.
Yes.
Yes.
And we need to begin to find joy in that reality and not joy in worldly comfort.
Yep.
Because what's going to happen is God is going to bring freedom to humanity.
Yep.
And you are not going to stop it.
Right.
and we can be like these Garcians. We're like, what are you doing? You're disrupting my comfort.
Yeah,
you know, you're destroying my livelihood. I'm not making as much money and all this stuff. Jesus, what are you doing? I don't want what you have. I don't want what you're selling. Leave.
Yeah. That is so good.
And we don't want to be like them. What we want to do is don't look at the worldly discomfort or the worldly comfort that we're missing out on, but look at the movement of God and the part we're playing in it and find joy in that.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Good.
All right. So number two was what God uses to bring freedom to people bound by these influences will disrupt worldly comfort. God, yes. I feel like I messed that up. I read it off my paper, and it makes sense. But anyways, what God uses to bring freedom, we're going to feel worldly discomfort.
Yeah.
We're going to miss out on worldly comfort, but that's okay. Because our joy comes from something else. And then number three, the last thing, is we have to find our comfort outside of what this world offers. We really do. Yeah. We have to set our heart and mind to find our comfort outside of what this world offers. Mark 8, verse 36 reads this, "For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul?"
Yeah.
I'm telling you, there is a real temptation out there to forfeit your soul for worldly comfort.
That's right. Yeah.
There is a battle going on today. It was going on yesterday. Mm-hmm. And it's going to go on tomorrow for us to forfeit our soul for worldly comfort.
Yeah.
Wow. And Jesus says, what does it benefit you to get the whole world yet lose your soul? There's something more important on the line.
Yeah.
There's something so much more valuable, and I think we get duped by the enemy in that temptation of living for worldly comfort and not for the movement of God.
Yeah.
And we don't want to be in that place. I don't want to be duped anymore.
No.
I don't want to be duped anymore. I want to just run hard into the movements of God.
Yeah. I want to work with him and cooperate with him, not against him in a sense of what he's doing.
If it hadn't been for him, I would have went on that trail of worldly comforts and just wanting to please all my friends, which we were all doing things that, you know, the world is doing, and it was destroying my soul, but I wanted to have all the friends. And if it wasn't God for breaking into my life at a certain time and just saying, like, I have something better for you, and just that one, you know, that one line, that one revelation, it was like, I mean, it took a while to get there, but if it hadn't been for God, then naturally it just would have been on that worldly comfort path. And I'm so glad he broke into my life. And I'm sure the same thing with you guys. I heard your testimony. Yes. And we would have been on that same path if it weren't for God. So
absolutely.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Yes, for sure. So those three things, it's only going to increase.
Mm-hmm.
Trouble, tribulation, the disappearance of worldly comfort. Mm-hmm. Is really only going to increase.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reality. As the closer it gets to Jesus coming back, those things are going to increase. The second thing is we're going to feel it. And we got to begin to find our comfort outside of that, which is number three, right? So those are the three things I want you to grab a hold of. And as we walk away from our gathering today, kind of taking those three things with us, because I really believe God is using this COVID-19 as kind of a preparing for his church and for the people of God to shake them awake from looking at worldly comfort as success and begin to dive into the finding the movement of God as their comfort and success.
Yes.
Amen.
Mm.
So I really believe we're in a time where God is preparing us for those future events that are going to take place, and where we can walk in true joy, not just fake joy, not just, well, you know, the Bible says I have to grin and bear it and like it, put a smile on my face, because that's not going to sustain us.
Right.
We really do need to begin to find true joy in the movement of God and not worldly comfort.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we must learn to put our faith not in worldly comfort, but in the movement of God. And it's there that we'll find joy. And this scripture I'm going to leave us with as we kind of wrap this up. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 reads this. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Let me repeat that. Though you have not seen him, you love him. There we go. You love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith. You're receiving the goal of your faith, and that's what gives us joy. And the goal of our faith isn't more things, isn't worldly comfort, isn't to be set up in the world's eyes, but the goal of our faith is the salvation of our souls. Is the salvation of our souls. That's the goal of our faith. That's what we find inexpressible joy. That's where we find joy unspeakable and full of glory, when we realize that worldly comfort really doesn't matter, but that my soul has been saved, that I have been brought into relationship with God, and God is moving in the here and now, reaching people and setting them free and bringing salvation to humanity. And that's where our joy is found. Amen. And that's where I want your joy to be found. Not in worldly comfort, but in a real God that's really moving in your life and the lives of others. Amen. So let's pray together. Father God, I just thank you. I thank you that you're a God that doesn't brush off the hard-headed or the dim-witted. Father, it takes me so long to get some things in there sometimes, God, but you're faithful, Father. You're faithful to us to bring us in to the place of knowing true joy, true satisfaction, true fulfillment, and it's in you and you alone, our cornerstone. So, Father, I pray once again with everyone here and everyone out there watching, Father, as believers, that we would once again set the mark, set the goal, not on worldly comfort, but on in walking with you in the movements of God in humanity, God. Oh, Lord, let us find joy that we walk with a God that walks with us through everything, not because we have a job that pays us more than we need, but God, that we have a God that forgives us. Even in our blunders, you love us. Let us find joy in that and not in the extra boat or the nice car or whatever it might be. Oh God, let us find joy in the movements of heaven, in the expansion of your kingdom. Yes, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise God. I thank you guys for being with us today. Those of you watching, I don't want you to leave. If you have not made Jesus Christ your personal Savior, I don't want you to leave without giving you that opportunity. You see, the Word of God says God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that he might die to set us free from our sins, and that we would forever be in relationship with him. And it's real simple. Call out on the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Ask God to forgive you your sins, make him Lord and Savior of your life, and follow him all the days of your life. And what the Word says is God fills us with his Holy Spirit, and he is now one with us. He will never leave you nor forsake you, and he will be with you through everything, and you will find joy in that relationship and not running after the things of worldly comfort. Amen. So if you made that prayer, you asked Christ to forgive you your sins, and you've made him Lord and Savior, we would love to hear from you. We'd love to send you a gift that will help you on your faith journey with him. So fill out that form. Or if you have any prayer requests, there's a form there too. We'd love to hear from you and pray with you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So praise the Lord. Have a great day. Enjoy this warm weather. If God is prompting you to give, we'd love for you to give to the Plattsburgh House of Prayer and what we're doing here. I always say we're doing more than just talking about God's Word. We're funding missionaries in Middle East and all around the world, in South America and all those places, to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we just ask you to ask God to see if you might give to this organization, and see what God says and just obey him. Amen. So be blessed. We love you guys. We love seeing you today. We just want you to know that we love you, we care about you, and if you need anything, let us know. God bless.
fears.